gorgeous morning it is, yeah? I will say my wife and I have been here 22 years now, I think. 22 years, I think. And this has been consistently the best summer we've ever enjoyed weather-wise here. It's just been absolutely beautiful. Just enough rain to keep the tomatoes growing, right? Cool at night, turn the AC off a little bit. Not so blazing hot during the day. Oh my goodness. And you'll be glad to know, this is my first weekend trying trifocals. Yes. I have tripped over things, I have missed steps, I have gone to shake hands with people and gone like this. So if I, and I don't even know how to introduce myself, because it's one of those things where I go, like I'm in a cloud of some sort. So if I miss your hand when I go to shake hands with you, or if I don't remember your name, it's actually because I'm so concentrating so hard on being able to see that. Hi, it's good to see you guys. I don't hear it. All right. Should I pray? Should we do that? All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the morning. We thank you for eyesight. We thank you for color and sharpness and depth. We thank you, Lord, that you allow us to view your creation with everything that you have made to delight yourself, Lord God, but also that we might delight in it and you. So, Father, this morning may we experience your grandeur, your glory, and your shimmering might. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Stirring heart. Oh,
Father, may we look forward to the time that the clouds peel back and you descend with a shout, Lord God. With a shout, we will see you and we'll be with you. Today, Father, may we engage with you in wonderful anticipation of your coming, but also the eager readiness of living by faith today. So move in us, move through us, transform us today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor, shake a hand, learn a name. If you're a kid, you need to go to the front and go to class. If you're not a kid, shake a hand, learn a name, say hello.
Everybody, welcome to Mosaic. It is great to have you here. My name is Heather, and we have a few announcements this morning. So if you are a guest with us, there is a white pamphlet in the back of your pew, and it's titled Things You Might Want to Know. Go ahead and take a look at that. There is also a gray connection card, and if you have a question or a prayer request, fill it out on that connection card, and once you do so, you can drop it into one of our giving boxes. They're located out here in the narthex and out each one of these doorways into the main hall, so you can just find it there and drop it in. We'll follow up appropriately. Okay, well, we have a lot that is coming up, so stay sharp, stay with me, because they are all important. So first off, we have slide. I don't know what the first one was. A Mitch McVicker, that's right. Okay, free concert, August 22nd at 7 p.m. Be here for that and bring a friend. It's going to be a fantastic time. Next, we have fall decorations. Now, Rachel does a great job in coming up with all of these ideas for the sanctuary, but there is a huge team that has to back her up and follow through with this. So we have the next three Wednesdays, August 16th, 23rd, and the 30th, from 9:30 to 11 a.m., where you can gather here at the church to work on those decorations. Fill out a connection card if you're interested to help, and drop it in the giving box. And if you have any questions about it as well, fill out that gray connection card. And if Wednesday doesn't work for you, our open art night is on Thursdays at 6 p.m. So it will be a time for fall decorations on Wednesdays and Thursdays as well. All right, and then A Kid Again is coming up. I believe it's the last Saturday of the month. So August 26th from 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. It's going to be at the Earhart Farm. So sign up downstairs in the hub, at the Welcome Center specifically in the hub. And choir is just around the corner. It's beginning on September 13th. Auditions, or I think that's what they call it. Either way, I'm not sure what it's officially termed. Not auditions, nope. It's just getting started. Anyone can join in.
What was the question?
Auditions for choir.
No. Even I could sing in the choir.
Well, there you have it,
folks. It's an awesome time. If you love to sing, if you love to be with people who sing, be here, be square. Go.
All right, it's going to be starting up here. And Awana is another thing that's going to be starting up in September. And we need a team to support this as well. It's a great opportunity for parents and children. So if you're interested in helping out with Awana so that we can offer it once again this year, fill out one of those gray connection cards. And now we have updating our contact information. You should have all gotten a form when you walked in the door today. And really, they want you to do it right now. So grab your pen, pencil, whatever's handy, and start filling it out. Your last name goes up at the top line, household. And then you can put your name in the primary contact line and any other adult that's in the house. If you have more than one adult, flip it over and you can fill out the adult information there. And there's kids information. Now, if you have more than five kids, we will get you another form. Congratulations, you have two forms. So, I get moving.
You what?
They want you to fill these out now.
Yeah, no, go ahead and fill them out. Honestly, here's the deal. There's a program, there's a website that we're using that we're introducing in September called Right Now.
Maybe they don't have pens.
And it's an actual ministry. It's an opportunity for you to go in and find Bible studies and children's material and different Christian material. We strongly recommend being part of this, but in order for us to do this, we need to update all of our information. So if you do that, that would be awesome. And just take a minute to do that.
I know. Does anyone else need another form? I have some here.
I had no idea where you went.
I'm here. I haven't left. You're stuck with me.
It must throw everybody off when I'm in the back and I hear this voice from over here. We good?
Did you get new glasses?
I did. I got new. You weren't here at the beginning, were you?
No,
I didn't mean to embarrass you in front of everybody. I'm wearing trifocals. What? I'm all out of whack. They're trifocals. I've never worn trifocals before.
Oh, really? I didn't know.
Well, because I kept doing this. And so my glasses guy said, well, you know, you can stop doing that. Then the girl who like sized me for him said, they make me sick to my stomach. I'm like, great, thank you very much. So,
is somebody picking these up off these forms or am I doing that?
You can run around and pick them up if you want.
Sure, I'd be happy to.
All right. Now, well, Heather's doing that and you're doing that. I would like to also get moving too. So if you can do two things at once, I can because I'm ADD. God made me to do two things at once, or five, or nine. So this is what I need you to do. I need you to grab your Bible and the notes. Now, we've been doing something recently. We've been talking about this idea of becoming lives that are worthy of gleaning or even possible for gleaning. So this is what I have. In the notes, I want to build something up here. And we're going to look at something interesting today. Hopefully it's interesting every time, but we're going to look at something in particular. In your notes, you're going to see a page with a lot of bullet points. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that we very briefly look at what we've been building on. Now, what you have in your notes are not only these bullet points, but they're verses to look up in terms of what it is that we need to know. So the first thing we want to look at is that God loves and God cares. God loves and cares. And this is not just for his children, it's all of creation. So he nurtures and sustains all of creation. God loves and he saves. God loves us and he saves us. He sent his son on our behalf. While we were his enemies, he died on our behalf. God loves and he cares, he saves and sustains and he provides all. One of the things in recognizing that God is God and who he is and what he's done is that we also recognize that everything that I have is his and I've received it from him. So next, in regard to his provision, he also commands us. He commands us in the context of all that to remember who he is, who we are, what he has done, and what he has given. And then he calls us to live by faith. And that living by faith is one of the short phrases we use to best exemplify this idea of living by faith, is that we would be converted from this idea of ownership to stewardship. That we would, instead of all the blessings and all the things that God has provided for us that we have received from him, not just to hold tight to it and to see it as something we own, but to recognize that we have been made administrators. We have been made distributors of kingdom stuff. So as we walk through our day, the grand opportunity we have is to extend the kingdom by that which God has given us, not to own, but to steward, and then distribute to the people around us. So we are little distributors. When we walk around, we have this beautiful opportunity to take that which we've been blessed with and hand it to the next person. So we want to go from ownership to stewardship. And in all that, he wants us to teach us these things. Do not hold tight to what he has, but we need to live in perpetual faith, trusting him and giving it away. And when we give, do not do it begrudgingly, but cheerfully. And in doing that, we're generous toward God and self in regard to taking care of oneself, those for whom we are all responsible in regard to the immediate surroundings, and those who are lacking, those who can pick from our lives. But we need to recognize this. To give, we have to get. But we have to get with the right motive. So a lot of times we don't have because we don't ask who? God. Right? And sometimes we ask and we don't get it because we ask with the wrong motives that we might spend it on our own pleasure. And in order for us to convert from wanting to spend something on our own, you know, in regard to spending on our own pleasure, as opposed to being willing to distribute it, is this whole new mindset, this new lens through which we see our world. That this is God and we are his. We were once slaves and in poverty and we are no longer. He provides everything that we have. And the purpose of that certainly is to take care of his children, demonstrate his love to the world, you know, to the world by loving his children. But then we would extend that love by giving away that which we've been given. Really, we'd give it away. But here's the deal. We can't give it away if we don't get it. And so first we have to treat God as God. How do we do that? We ask him. We pray to him. And then when we ask, we make sure that our motives have been purified. That I'm not just spending it on my own pleasure, but I'm distributing that. I'm distributing the kingdom. God's heartbeat is then seen in that. So to give, we must have. And to have, we, listen, here's the deal. We have to work. Because we can't reap what we don't sow. And then even in that, if we reap sparingly, we will, or we sow sparingly, we'll reap sparingly. If we reap generously, we will, if we sow generously, we'll reap generously. So we must work. But here's the deal. In all of this, when we think about the idea of working, again, we think of that as something we have to do. No, no. You know what it is? It's something we get to do. By working, we get to demonstrate our loyalty and our honor of God and then put ourselves in a position to be used by God to be able to give away. And so we're actually extending God's kingdom through our work. And I don't know if we think about that very often. Not only is this a mission field in regard to where I go to work, but it is what supplies me. God's able to bless me and supply me by the work of my hands, which he has enabled me to do, and that be able to give away that which I've earned, that which he blesses with. So to have, we got to work. So what do we? How do we do? How do we do this? We cultivate fields. We have enough to live, have more to save, and even more to give. And why do we give? To let the world see God. To thank him, to honor him, to reveal him, to show our trust in him, to practice faith and faithful living, living in that perpetual trust. We are to give as it has been given to us, and this is the evidence of God in us, and the world sees that. That's all what we've done in the last couple months. Well, we're gonna look at something that's gonna seem obtuse, okay? It looks like it's gonna come in from the angle. I need you to turn to Matthew chapter 25. I need you to turn to Matthew chapter 25. Now, to do all this, we have to have a calibrated heart, and we talked about having a calibrated heart when we looked at three or four passages. We looked at a rich man who held on to everything that he had, another rich man who refused to let go and then lost his soul in the process. But it began to, when we began to see, then James says, we have to check our motives. And then we went to Matthew 25 and the sheep and the goats. That calibrated heart looks like this. It God says to us, hey, when I was hungry, you gave me food. And the calibrated heart says, when did I see you hungry and give you food? When I was naked, you clothed me. And the calibrated heart says, when did I see you and clothe you? And he goes through this whole process. And he says, well, when you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. In other words, the calibrated heart starts to give it's out of its own nature. And so much so, and so naturally, that we don't even realize that we're giving anymore. Part of it is because we're being gleaned from. We've developed this life, and we've cultivated our fields in such a way that people can glean from us, and we don't even realize it's happening. It's an awesome thing in the field of time and energy and wisdom and righteousness, that somebody recognizing that for some reason would come over and say, hey, Dave, can I ask you a question? And Dave goes, sure, let me give you a minute. Well, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Well, ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Well, da-da-da, ba-ba-ba-ba. And you know what just happened? Dave didn't even realize it. Somebody gleaned from him. Time. Energy. Dignity. Wisdom. Appreciation. All because he was just willing, available, and naturally gave because of a cultivated field. That's how natural this becomes. And that's the art of the calibrated heart. Well, here's the deal. There are some passages prior to that that I want to take a look at. Because here's the deal. God has done all these things. God has done all these things. We are recipients. We're beneficiaries of all that God has done. We are his administrators. That means he is this master who has given us everything. He's made us trustees of his estate. Now, here's the next thing. We are responsible for what we do with it. We're responsible for what we do with it. We are held responsible. There's this beautiful two-way street between us and God. First is his grace giving us life, and then his continued grace that provides for us everything we need. The return to that is that we would love him and honor him in such a way as to conduct ourselves as he has conducted himself. That we are, because here's the deal. His purposes, his sole purpose to leave us on earth is this, that we would be conformed into the likeness of his son. Stop. His sole purpose, the only reason we're still here on earth, is that we would be conformed in the likeness of his Son. And here's what's cool about that. If we are conformed into the likeness of the Son, we reflect our God. And we're natural evangelists. We can't help it. Because people see Jesus in us, and they go, right? It's amazing how four O's can speak an entire conversation, isn't it? Okay, so here we go. All right, so we're in Matthew 25. We're going to start at verse 1. And this one, this first parable, isn't going to look like it fits. But this is what I want us to do. I want us to look at the level of responsibility and wisdom with which we're called to live. And both in appreciation for what God has done and anticipation of what he will do. So I'm going to pray before we read. Father, we thank you for your word. And pray, Lord God, that you would just lead us through your word in such a way as to inflame our hearts and to form us and shape us into your likeness and to help us to extend your kingdom. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, it says, at that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like. Now, this is a really important phrase. We're going to stop right here. At that time. We're going to see that time is when the bridegroom comes. We're going to see that as we read on. But look what it says. It says, at that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like. The kingdom of heaven will be like. What is Jesus doing? First of all, there are three parables that are tied together. There's this one. The next one is the parable of the talents. We're going to look at that in a moment. And then the third one is the sheep and the goats. And each one of these is Jesus declaring, saying to us, this is what it's going to be like when the kingdom comes forward, when it's birthed. So he's saying that at this time, it'll be, this is what the kingdom of heaven will be like. It'll be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, this is a really important thing we do not understand. This is very, very cultural, Jewish culture. In fact, the Jewish people were about the only people who celebrated marriage and weddings the way the Jews did. And so let me enlighten us just a little bit. Historically and culturally, this is what a wedding looked like in Judea or Galilee or the Palestine area. A young couple would be betrothed for about a year. They would work toward this idea of marriage. And the wedding day would be celebrated by not only the family, but the entire village. Now, where we get married and we take off and we leave for a week or two, what we call a honeymoon, that is not what they did in this time. In this time, what they did was they would get married and they would stay in their home for 1 week, 7 days. And for that 7 days in their home, they would entertain anyone who showed up. And that would be the wedding feast. That would be the celebration and the party that would follow the ceremony itself. So this young couple would come and they'd get married and then they'd be escorted to their home. Now we're going to talk about that in a minute because they would take the longest route possible to get home. What would happen would be the bridal party and the family would take the couple and they would take them all through the village and all through the surrounding area and they would take the longest route they possibly could. You know why? Because the entire community was committed to making sure that first of all that the couple were celebrated and then that they took responsibility for the welfare and the health of this marriage. And so what they would do is they would take the longest route they could to make sure everybody knew in the entire community that this couple just got married. And by the time they got back to the house, what would happen is all the wedding party would be waiting, and they'd be waiting with lamps lit. And those lamps lit were for two reasons. One, this would usually occur at night, and it was illegal to be on the street without a lit lamp. And the second was that lamp was an indication of your readiness to receive the bridegroom and the bride and to be escorted into the party with them. Now, I want us to understand in this context, you know, we feast constantly. Constantly. In our culture, it's hard for us to imagine what a wedding feast would be like. And the reason is because these people were very poor, and they lived very austere lives, and they eat very, very little. A couple barley loaves, little like stone-shaped and stone-sized barley loaves, and a little bit of fish, a little bit of unleavened bread. This would, you know, maybe some figs and some raisin cakes, and they would take these along with them, and they would nibble on those all day long or have four small meals a day. And that would be the extent of their nutrition day in and day out. Not like that for us. Not at all. Yesterday I made the mistake of making quesadillas out of corn tortillas. So I had these fresh corn tortillas, and I took cheese, and I put them in there, and I microwaved those for 1 minute. There were three of them. And then I took 8 pieces of salami per quesadilla. Right? Oh, don't wince at me. Okay, and then what I did is I put she's over here going, ugh. So, what I would do is put a little string of yellow mustard in the middle of that. And I would fold it over, I put it in my Chuck Foreman grill. Get rid of all the grease. There you go. All right. I can do a commercial. So then my lovely wife, something, I got these three wonderful salami quesadillas, which I'm really excited about. And I have this dip that my wife makes. It's artichoke and it's got cheese in it. And it's got, it's just wonderful. And I make some of that and I get some corn chips and I got those ready to scoop that stuff out of there. And I put it on the back table because it was a really beautiful day. And I had my laptop there and I've got my quesadillas and I've got my chips and I've got my dip and I've got some salsa and I'm ready to roll. Sherry comes home from her walk. She says, "You ready for a hamburger?" I was like, sure. How many you want? I'm thinking, one? That all? Yes, I made some lunch. I told you I was going to make a lot. But this was a really cool, get this. She made me a big burger out of sirloin beef, and it was like a pound. You know what I was able to do? Take one quesadilla, slap the burger on the quesadilla, put the other quesadilla on the burger. And then I took that artichoke dip and went like that. And then I dipped it in ketchup and mustard and I ate it with chips. And I was really nutritious. I drank a Coke with it. Because Coke does two things. It tastes good, and then it cleans your mouth, because that'll clean anything. So it cleans all the grease out of your mouth. Oddly enough, 5 minutes in, I said to my wife, "I think I ate too much." That was one lunch. I nibbled on it for a while. That was one lunch. Now, I go through all of that to say this. We feast all the time. In fact, in our country, nearly every meal we eat is a feast. That's not what it was like in Palestine. For them, they waited for these wedding ceremonies. And the reason I'm going into this, the way I'm going into it is this. When Jesus begins his parable, everybody there knew exactly what he was talking about. And what they were anticipating was this week-long feast that they'd be invited to, where they got to go into the home of the bride and groom, woo, and be put, and I don't even have these glasses on yet. All right. Where they have this week-long feast where they're invited in to be with the bride and groom, and the celebration would go on and on and on. They never got to eat like this unless it was this kind of an occasion. They never got to celebrate like this unless it was this kind of occasion. This was a really, really big deal. See, and if we don't get that, we don't understand this parable. Because we would make light of it. We don't get it. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. This is the wedding party, waiting, anticipating for the bride and the bridegroom to come back from this long excursion through the community. Now, here's the deal. Nobody knew how long that was going to take because the rest of the wedding party and the family took them around, would take them on the longest possible route. And you never quite knew when they were going to be back. And so you had to wait in anticipation. You need to be prepared for their coming. You need to be looking forward to what this would bring. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were full. Ooh. Okay, now he's setting us up. He's saying, this is what I want you to learn from this. He says, five were foolish. Five lacked wisdom. And five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not do what? Did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. And the bridegroom was what? The bridegroom was a long time in coming. Now, there are two things I want us to get from this. Number one is I want us to look at this as Jesus was speaking to the Jewish people, because this is who he was talking to. You know what he was saying to them? The Messiah was a long time in coming. And you've been waiting for a long, long time. And those of you who have anticipated this but have not taken into consideration that it may take some time, you have forgotten to some degree that he's on his way. And so when he comes, you're going to miss out on this. And in your foolishness, you were not intentional or wise about making sure that you were ready. And when he comes, To those of you who do recognize the occasion, those of you who do recognize the import of this, those of you who do function with a little bit of intentionality and strategy and wisdom, you are prepared for his coming, and therefore you've seen it. And even if he were to come at a time you didn't expect, you're ready. See, that's what he was saying. So we read on, look what it says. It says, five of them were foolish and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in their jars and jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they were all became drowsy and they fell asleep. They all began to kind of relax a little bit and realize that it's going to be a little while, and they all just, they fell asleep. Both the wise and the foolish fell asleep. Look what it goes on to say now. At midnight, the cry rang out, here's the bridegroom, come and meet him. This is the opportunity for us to be invited into this thing. And if we're ready, we get to go. If we're not, we'll be left out. Look what it says. Then the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish ones said to the wise, give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out. Now, here's where it seems contradictory in regard to what we've been learning. And that is this. The foolish ones go to the ones who have extra oil, the ones who were wise and had put some up and made sure they were intentional about making sure they were prepared for their coming because it may take longer. They thought through, okay, this is what's happening. This is what could happen. I need to be sure that I have this, this, and this in place so that when they come, I'll be ready regardless of when they arrive. The others just thought, ooh, great party, let's go. Now, we're talking about lives to be gleaned from. And we're thinking, okay, awesome. These wise ones have extra oil. Therefore, they have lives that can be gleaned from. Stop for a minute. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about being responsible. There's a principle I brought up last week. And it was this. That we sometimes, despite the fact that we've been saved by grace, we've had God's grace lavished on us. We are seated in the heavenlies, according to Ephesians 2. That we have these awesome riches and abundance of life in Christ Jesus. We have that in eternity. A lot of us here on earth live lives of perpetual and self-inflicted poverty. We are not ready. And it's because we lack discipline, and we lack wisdom, and we lack a sense of responsibility. See, what God is saying essentially right here is this. Here's the deal. I love the fact that you're here to meet me, but I'm going to hold you responsible for what I've given you. And I'm going to endow you with the wisdom of the Word and the Holy Spirit so that you can live intentionally in such a way as to be prepared for my coming. And listen, to be prepared for my coming in every occasion. Because this is what I want us to understand the reality of today as Christians. We don't realize it, but every day is chock full of occasions where Jesus Christ is revealed. Stop. Every day is chock full of occasions. Full of occasions. Where Jesus Christ is revealed. In other words, an opportunity for us to share the kingdom in every circumstance by allowing him to be revealed through our lives and are being prepared for that moment. Isn't that crazy? See, we're talking about Jesus' second coming, but we have to realize in the midst of the world and our walking with him, he's coming every day, and he comes every day in the shell of each one of us. And every occasion we find ourselves, every circumstance, every conversation, every interaction, this is an opportunity for Jesus to be revealed. And we have to ask ourselves, are we ready? Do we have oil in our lamps? Have we spent time in the Word? Have we spent time in prayer? Have we spent time in fellowship? Have we spent time in service? Do we recognize the wonderful responsibility and privilege we have to bring the kingdom of heaven forward? And that every occasion we find ourselves is an opportunity for us to be a blessing to the person with whom we reside, we walk, we converse, we work. And so what Jesus is saying is here, listen, be responsible, be wise, listen closely, do what you need to do, be prepared for my coming. And certainly this is true of eternity in regard to first our salvation and then our perpetual work with him. But the perpetual work is his being revealed every day in every circumstance and in every situation we find ourselves. That's 1 Peter 1, if you want to put it down in your notes. Isn't this wonderful? This is the joyful responsibility we have. Now look what it goes on to say. Actually, read that on your own. Go down to verse 14. Now grab your notes because we're going to get going. This is now the teaching starts. Because one of the things I want us to see is this, that not only does Jesus hold us responsible, he gives us everything we need to be able to do it. Here, I think we get confused. God doesn't ask us to do anything that he didn't equip us to do. Let me say that again. God doesn't ask us to do anything that he has not equipped us to do. That is a precursor. I want you to take that into consideration because that should change how you view everything you do. You ever get in the middle of something and you ask God, why would you do this? There's no way I can do this. I'm not strong enough. I'm not deep enough. I'm not this. I'm not that. I'm not the other thing. Do you think somehow God was surprised that you found yourself there? With the person with whom you find yourself? You think he's surprised by that? Like, oh, golly, I didn't know you were going to run into Dave today. My bad. I would have prepared you if I'd known that. Is that true? First of all, that should give us confidence. It should give us confidence that regardless of where I find myself, if I have oil for my lamp, if I take seriously this wonderful responsibility that God has given me to not only be his child, but also be his steward, and at this moment he's giving me everything I need to be able to not only live the life he's called me to live, but then to allow others to glean from me in the process, that that's a privilege, and that he has chosen this specifically for me, knowing who I am. Every conversation, every circumstance, good or bad, worthy of celebration or tragedy, he's not surprised. He wants to be revealed. He wants to be shown because he's going to show up. He's going to. Will we be ready? Will we be ready to allow him to be shown through us? And do we see this as not only a responsibility, listen to me, but a privilege? Now, we're going to look at a parable that used to be called the parable of the talents. I'm not exactly sure when the name changed, but when the NIV rewrote it, they retitled it, because that's what the NIV does. They retitled it the parable of the bags of gold, which is still wrong. Okay, parable of the talents was wrong, and bags of gold is wrong. And I'll tell you why. Now, understand I'm saying it was wrong, and those titles aren't the Bible. Okay, those are titles that are inserted by the translators to help you to find a story in case you don't know what this story is about. The problem is when they tell you what the story is about, they truncate the story and they say, oh, this is what the story is about. And so when we read it, we go, well, that's what the story was about. And so we get blocked from seeing what the story is actually about. And generally speaking, when we title something, it's usually how it affects me. This is about me. Because that's how we tend to look at things. Let's change the lens. Let's flip it around. Remember, when we think it's about me, it's like we're looking through the wrong end of a telescope. We get the big fat lens, you know, and we're looking at this tiny little God who gets to serve me. Right? Let's flip it. Because we need to look through the little end and see this giant God who loves me. This is God and what he does. And this story is about our Father. It's not about bags of gold. It's about our Father. It's not even about our diligence. Because when we look at this in regard to about us and bags of gold and our diligence, we think it's on us. Now, I'm not taking the responsibility off us. No, no. What I'm saying is, what is the motive for our taking responsibility? What is it that should drive me toward doing this the way God calls me to do it? And it goes all the way back to what we talked about months ago. God is a God of love. And this love is kind and cares. Amen. And then he wants us to reciprocate. So let's look at the story. Verse 14. Now he uses the word again. And then the phrase, it will be like. The reason we have to stop there for a minute is because we have to go back to verse 1. We're not going to, but I'm going to rephrase. I'm going to phrase what we looked at in verse 1. And when he says again, it will be like, he's saying, and again, the kingdom of heaven will be like this. So he's referring again to the coming of the Savior, to the coming of the Messiah, and to the kingdom of heaven coming into fruition. So look what it says. And it will be like a man going on a journey. This is the kingdom of heaven among us. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. Who did what? He did what? He called his what? He called his servants. So this is a man who apparently has means. And he's going to go on a long journey. And so he grabs some of his servants and he calls them to him. Now, if we stop right there and we take it a little bit out of context, what's happening is he's just arbitrarily calling a bunch of servants. And we go, well, okay, well, he's the boss and he's calling his servants. He's going, okay, send them out. So look what it says now. It says, again, it'll be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted it. Did what? He entrusted his wealth to them. Wow. Think about that for a minute. So now he's calling servants, and what he's doing is he's entrusting his estate to them. He's saying, I'm going on a journey. Come here. I need you to help me with something. Let's stop there for a moment. What kind of a privilege is it to be given that kind of responsibility that your master, who is going to go away for a long journey, would grab you and say, come here, I'm going to entrust my estate to you. Isn't that crazy? This is a master. Wow. This is a master who is saying to his servants, I trust you this much. I'm going to take my estate. I'm going to distribute it among you while I'm gone. That's a big ask, isn't it? And we need to put ourselves in the position first of the servants and go, wow. It gets better than this, though. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. He entrusted his wealth to them. Let me ask you something. What's the kingdom of heaven actually about? Is it not about the Father? And is it then not about the Father and his kingdom? Is it then not about the Father and his kingdom and those he would invite into the kingdom? And that those who he would invite into the kingdom, that he would then entrust them to distribute the wealth of the kingdom to those who would receive it? Is that not what our Father does? Do we not realize that he is the master and he's on a long journey and we have no idea when he's coming back, and what he's done is he's gathered us up as his servants and he's entrusted the wealth of the kingdom to us? Do we recognize that? Do we understand that privilege and responsibility? Do we understand how esteemed we have been when the master calls us as his servants and says, here is what's most valuable to me. I'm going to give it to you to steward, to invest in, to extend, to expand, to multiply? Because that's exactly who we are. But let's talk about the heart of the Father a little bit more. Watch this. First of all, this master somehow trusts his servants. That tells us that the relationship between the master and the servants must have been pretty decent. In order for him to have actually realized that his servants would honor him and respect him and treat that which he has with respect and dignity, that's a big deal. And this is what the master apparently is doing. But it gets even more beautiful than this. Look at what it says next. Again, it'll be like a man going on a journey who has called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold. To another 2 bags of gold. And to another 1 bag. Look, don't stop. Each according to what? Each according to what? What's it? No, read it. Each according to what? I can't hear everybody. Each according to what? His ability. Now, the reason I'm asking you to say that is because this is the heart of the Father. And the wisdom of the Father. Love and wisdom always walk side by side. So here is a master who trusts the servants in such a way as when he goes on a long journey, he would say, I believe my servants get it. I think they know exactly what I want. I think they know who I am. I think they know exactly how I would go about this business. And I'm going to entrust my wealth to them while I'm gone. And in fact, nowhere in the story does he come back to check on everybody to make sure it's done right. He doesn't even give them any instructions as to how it should be done. He just gathers them up and he says, now, here's the cool thing. Remember at the beginning we said, okay, he gathered his servants. And we think, okay, he just gathered some servants. No. He shows more insight than that. Now he's showing even deeper wisdom. He gives 1 5 bags of gold, 1 2, and 1 1 according to their what?
Ability. You know what that tells me? Not only did he call his servants, listen, not only does he trust the servants in regard to their, in general, understanding who he is and what he's about, he knows them specifically. He knows them by name. He knows them by ability. And listen, he knows them by capacity. Because our ability and our capacity walk side by side. And so what he's actually doing is this. He's calling servants to his side and he's saying, I'm going to entrust my wealth to you while I'm gone on this long journey. But understand this. I've watched you and I know you. And I will give you these things according to your ability. I will not ask more of you than you're able to handle, both in ability and capacity. That is not only wisdom, that is love. That is grace. A graceless, unloving master would oppress each one of them with more than they could handle, or would discourage them by not enough. This one took each individual and he looked them in the eye and said, I know you and I know your ability and I know your capacity. Here, go. Here, go. Here, go. Now, we're not going to go any further today. We will be finishing this next week because what we're going to learn next week is even more important than we learned this week in terms of how we apply this. But this is what I want us to leave with right now. I want us to see the heart of our Father. I want us to see that this story really has little to do with us. It has to do with a loving, wise master who recognizes that he has a kingdom and his desire is not to rule this kingdom by himself, but to bring his servants in to have us join him and administer his kingdom and to help steward all that is his. And that he does this not arbitrarily. He doesn't just grab Jim Sorensen and say, hey, Jim, you know, hey, I know I'm not even sure who you are, but here's some stuff and this is what I expect from you. He didn't do that. He knew them so well, he looked at them, he picked each one of them specifically, he gave them very specific things to work with, but never gave them any instruction because he knew them. He knew their ability, he knew their capacity. How does this translate to today? There is not a single moment, as servants of our master that he is not aware of who we are and what he's giving us in relation to our ability, our gifts, our talents, our skills and experiences, and our capacity. He promises he will never allow our faith to be tested or tempted beyond its ability to bear up underneath it. And even then, he gives us a way out when we feel like the weight is coming down. God is that faithful to us. He is that gracious to us. He is that wise. He is that loving. He is that aware. And he made us specifically. Put Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 right here. We are God's workmanship, created to do good works prepared in advance for us to do. We have been given gifts to accomplish the things of the kingdom. And then he brings us into every circumstance we find ourselves just according to our ability and just according to our capacity. We never have to be concerned about our faith being crushed underneath the weight of the expectation because God knows who we are. There is not a moment today that God is not aware that you'll be walking into it. In fact, he's there waiting for you to get there. The key for us is to have oil for our lamps, to take the responsibility of being prepared, having our lenses cleaned and seeing it, looking through the telescope from the right end. This is not about me, it's about my Father. This is not about my stuff, it's about the kingdom. It is not about me and the kingdom as much as it is, me and my stuff in regard to my having been blessed, but that God wants to extend himself through us and bring others into the kingdom with us and use us to do it. Period. Our dad knows us, and he calls us to his side by name. He knows exactly how he's made us and with what capacity. And he has said, here is what I have for you to do today, perfectly suited for you, created in advance for you to do. And I am knitting you together, conforming you into Christ, and I'm walking beside you. I'm there in you, I'm there before you, and I'll be there after you. Join me in my work. Join me. Do not be afraid. Do not be crushed. Lean into me. Does this make sense this morning? Mm-hmm. Good. Good. today we get to approach our world this way. Yes, we have been saved by grace, and yes, we are sustained by grace, and yes, our Father lives in us and lives through us and has gifted us and strengthened us. He is there before us, he is there with us, and he will be there after us. But he also calls us to responsibility and to wisdom. He calls us to be ready for every moment, every occasion. No occasion will occur that will crush me, but there will be occasions that I have not taken the responsibility to be prepared, and I will have missed the opportunity because my eyes won't see them. Listen, my eyes won't see them. Preparation is what opens our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to empathize. Preparation is what gives us the stuff we need to give and the loose hands with which to give it. Preparation is what causes our feet to go. Preparation is what allows us to respond in kind. Preparation. The knowledge that our God is extending his kingdom and is choosing to use his servants as he goes off on a long journey. He entrusts us with the kingdom. That's a privilege and an honor. Then he gives us everything we need according to our ability and our capacity. Then he says, now go. And next week we'll talk about how this grows. Amen? Band, go ahead and get in place. I'm going to pray. Father, we thank you for your grace, for your love. We thank you for your wisdom. We thank you, Lord God, that you would give us the privilege and responsibility of the kingdom. And in doing so, Lord God, you would do so according to what you've done. You, Father, know us by name. You call us by name. And you give us every opportunity according to the ability and capacity you've given us. So, Lord, may we be responsible and prepared. May we spend time in your word. May we spend time in prayer. May we spend time in worship and fellowship. May we spend time in serving the body. And then may our eyes be open to see and our ears to hear and our hearts pumping with empathy. Gift us, Lord God, not that we would spend it on our own pleasures, but we would extend the kingdom through it. Loosen our hands in what we have and give us feet to go. And remind us that you're already there waiting, anticipating our coming. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Father, may this week be a week where we recognize your heart, your grace, your faithfulness, that we are stewards of your kingdom, your stuff, that you're on a long journey. You have entrusted us. But you've not just taken your servants and entrusted your kingdom to us. You know each one of us. You know us. You know our names and how you've made us. You've prepared works in advance for us to do. And then you've given us those opportunities according to our ability and our capacity. You are a faithful God who gives us not only this incredible responsibility, but the privilege of going about the business of the King. I pray, Lord God, that we would also see this, see the responsibility in it in regard to where we're responsible, that we would be wise and intentional, that we would plan, that we would recognize, Father, you are long in coming, whatever that means. So as long as it's today, may we be ready for every occasion, realizing that, Jesus, you'll be revealed in every moment. You're waiting to come forward. So, Lord, may we be ministers of the gospel. May we be administrators of the kingdom. May we be distributors of your wealth. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have an awesome week.